Subject, architecture interaction. Lecturer, Paul Johnson. Recorded on the 10th of the 4th, 1980.
Sydney architect Harry Seidler was appointed visiting professor in architecture at the University of New South Wales for the first semester of 1980. He was born in Vienna in 1923. After studies in England, he graduated from the University of Manitoba in Canada. Later, he did postgraduate work at Harvard University under the founder of the Bauhaus, Walter Gropius, and studied design under the painter, Josef Albers. In 1948, Seidler started to practice in Sydney, and the many buildings he has completed since then have earned him an international reputation. Amongst his best known buildings are Sydney's Blues Point Tower, Australia Square and the MLC Centre, and Canberra's Trade Group offices. A recent overseas work is the Australian Embassy in Paris. In this lecture, Seidler deals with the interactions between all the visual arts and architecture, and the historic basis for this interdependence, which he feels should be a guiding and motivating force in architectural design.
Modern architecture, as we have come to understand it, has had a history of just over 3/4 of a century now. In spite of that, it cannot be said that there is any consensus of opinion about its viability. There's always been a reluctance on the part of those who practice it and those who criticize it to state any dogma. Those dogmas that have been stated, such as this new architecture is functional, it is logical, it responds to the new technology, are rather obvious and rather facile descriptions of what it's really all about. What I will try and develop is the thesis that the visual arts of our time has had as much to do with the visual language that has come to make up modern architecture as the technological components, and possibly also the practical ones, obviously. Now, this visual language didn't suddenly come about, but it was developed in a continuum of a stream that has been going on virtually throughout the ages. There is nothing new in the fact that architecture, the visual arts, painting, sculpture, have always benefited and moved together from each other. Now, there is obviously a reluctance on the part of people in the 1920s and 1930s, which really is the cradle time of our architecture of the 20th century, to state that visual characteristics of a particular discernible variety. What was asked for at that time was freedom to express a new vision. Now, the results of this vision we have around us in various forms. We have those who have, throughout the intervening years, simply responded to copying superficial tendencies of modern buildings. And on the whole, the public has tended to reject that. And we know, of course, that architecture has had a bad name in recent times, the concrete jungle, the unfortunate total environments in our cities as they have grown, particularly since the Second World War. There are always those who say, we have a new way, we have a new direction that everyone should follow. And these, every Monday morning, something new cliches have become rather tiresome. And I have lived long enough to remember them back in the 1950s and 1960s when decorative classicism was the in thing. Eliminate everything else. From now on, buildings are to be as symmetrical as they were in classical times. Use modern technology, but that was the catchword. Some years of the 1960s, an ad hocism was the fashion. Design things just as they occur to you. And the latest fad, of course, that has had considerable press throughout the architectural media is rather pathetically called postmodernism, as though modernism as such is actually finished with, and there is something new going beyond it. Why I call it pathetic is the fact that it simply has no basis in historical, consequential thought. It has no basis other than saying, from now on, why not dress up things as they used to look? Why not suddenly use a Greek column in the middle of a modern building? What is simply sadly true is there is no socially responsible direction evident in this new mode. It can and must be called morally irresponsible because it doesn't claim to be of any social use to people, and that has always been a component of architecture, can never be ignored. Now, what I'd like to point out is the fact that the visual basis of architecture is something that is in constant flux. It is moving, it is changing with time. But there are certain fundamental criteria about the way 20th century man's eyes respond to characteristics of what is around them. And that can be shown to be viable, to be to some extent still so today as it was in 1925 or 1930, that rich new developments in the arts have come about that have changed our attitude to what is beautiful, what is visually desirable and worth pursuing in architecture. Now, what I think a good starting off point would be to just examine what painters have done in the last three quarters of a century and how that has influenced, the impetus that they have shown has influenced architects, would be to simply say that it is nothing new. It is almost a truism to state and assert that the arts and technology have always moved hand in hand throughout history, that painting, sculpture, and architecture have influenced and benefited and learned from each other throughout times. And the fact that they have been so related throughout history has been at various times to the point where they have virtually merged so as to render their particular boundaries to be quite indistinct. And there probably is no better starting point to illustrate that than the architecture and sculpture in Greek times, which have very often been the prototype for building throughout many centuries. The Parthenon in Greece is the very essence of architecture and sculpture fused. The caryatid figures are there not only to adorn, but in fact be the architectural and structural support itself. The very essence of Gothic building is a fusion of sculpture with architectural sculptural form. And in the 17th century, the theatrical flamboyance imbued in its sculpture and the architecture of the time into an indistinguishable whole, which couldn't be better demonstrated than by the work of the two great architects of that era, Bernini, whose sculptural fountain is in the foreground, and Borromini, whose church is at the rear. Now, closer to our own time, at the turn of the century, when a change from classic tradition was ripe, the proposed new directions were as much painterly as they were simultaneously tectonic. The period of L'Art Nouveau demonstrates an early form of this fusion. even the earliest manifestations of iron construction by Belgium's Victor Horta is embellished by the artistic direction of the time, the naturalistic, plant-like forms that are also paralleled by his contemporary Hector Guimard. And here in Horta's staircase, this famous staircase, it is quite obvious that although we have here quite unadorned structural elements, an I-beam, as we would today use in quite an uncovered fashion, is here twisted into the form as the mode of the time dictated. Antonio Gaudi, the famous Spanish architect, practiced in Barcelona. And he's one who molded the stone pillars and facades of his buildings with a knowing constructor's hand. It wasn't only the Art Nouveau taste of the time, but it was his structural understanding of the knuckle jointedness, the fact that elements that support also need to become heavier at their intersections. So here, a simultaneous tectonic and sculptural hand is at work. Hector Guimard, who I have mentioned in Europe, similarly treated cast iron, which we can see in this entrance to the Paris underground. And here, there could be nothing more characteristic of the appearances of the time than these plant-like cast metal sculptural forms, which his contemporary Otto Wagner, a very important architect in Vienna, used in his quite magnificent stations, also built for a system of underground trains in Vienna. In fact, if we were to compare the detail contained in these buildings, the art, the mode, the fashion of the time, it would be almost as if one were to use the forms used by the painter of that era, probably the best known being Aubrey Beardsley. Now, when the threshold of our own time was reached, which really is the time just before the First World War, the rejection of everything that had gone before, and all these men that I have shown so far, have rejected classic tradition, which had ruled the Western world's taste for centuries before. And with the development of new materials, the new movement that said, no more of this, let us speak our own language appropriate to our time, assumed revolutionary zeal. In particular, this was evidenced in Vienna in a movement called the Wiener Werkstätte, a movement which called for a new morality in architecture, and independent freedom and expression for art. The inscription on this, the Secession building built by the architect Joseph Olbrich, says, "Die Zeit ihre Kunst, die Kunst ihre Freiheit. To each time, its art. To art, its freedom." Now, when finally the freedom to express our own genuine language of the 20th century came, the Bauhaus, that famous school of design, was at the forefront of developments, because its thesis set about to fuse art and technology. Although it is so often misunderstood and always only taken to be a building characteristic of new functional expression, that was obviously its aim as well. But its philosophic message was the new need to bring art and technology together, as they always had been in the past, and which had been interrupted, a tradition interrupted by the eclecticism, the copying, the redoing of classic form throughout centuries before. The Bauhaus concentrated on industrial design and particularly on visual education for all those who entered it, who wanted to be either painters, sculptors, architects, industrial designers, and so on. Its visual education and its importance, I think, is evidenced by the fact that this building, which was built in 1925 by Gropius, had fallen into complete disrepair, and also had, of course, been disowned by the not only the government, but generally by society, and had become a ruin. In recent times, the building has been entirely and meticulously restored since it had been declared a national monument in East Germany. So here we have the Bauhaus today, identical and in much better physical shape than it even was in 1925 when it was due. Now this revival, I think, is symbolic of the fact that the world is recognizing its importance and the importance of the things that it produced and the people who ran it produced and did in the years to come. Now here's a picture taken in the early 1920s of the key figures that ran this school of design. People in the center, we have Walter Gropius, and the other names are Moholy Nagy, Clay, Itten, Kandinsky, Breuer, and a score of others that are well enough known. Now, what did these people do, and what did they set about to achieve? It was to renew our attitude to the sense of space, the tactile sense, the sense of color. And probably this exercise given to students to extract the most possible out of a given material will demonstrate the mentality behind this kind of art education. Take a piece of paper and extract the most you can out of it, which is to make it into a structure. And here we have a over a meter high tower built out of a flat piece of paper, simply by folding it, by gluing a little strip of another bit of paper onto it, and you thereby get the most for the least, the most tangible, physical, and visual effect. To make paper stand up is a structural achievement in itself, because it is a weak material. To make it be visually exciting by its very nature, the fact that you've done this incredible thing, and to do so with a minimum of effort is what the new times indicated. Now, this kind of training was pursued further in later years, but just to look at the end results of that kind of training. We have actual products now reproduced at the restored Bauhaus, meticulously as they were more than half a century ago, theater seats designed by Marcel Breuer. I'm afraid the world today doesn't have theater seats that are as intelligent, as minimal, as logical as this particular set of fold-up group seating. Lighting in the Bauhaus, a new departure. Just imagine how revolutionary this kind of design of little tubes connected by tubes of metal into almost a sculptural element in itself. What a far cry it is from the trite and trivial things that the world seems to be satisfied with since. But probably no other chairs are as well known today as those designed in 1924 by Marcel Breuer, and now, after more than half a century later, suddenly emerged again as one of the most popular things throughout the world, the Vasily chair, designed for his friend Vasily Kandinsky at the Bauhaus. His metal spring, automatically spring quality chairs that move as you sit in them, covered with cane seats, very common throughout the world now, again being recognized as remarkable achievements of the most for the least, and the fact that they're easily produced by industry makes them that much more valuable and obviously still appreciated. Now, the one institution that pursued that kind of training, which is so rare, in fact, has virtually never or hardly ever been repeated since the Bauhaus, has been Black Mountain College in the United States. Black Mountain College was founded in the early 1930s, and Joseph Albers, a Bauhaus painter, went there to teach. Now, what did he teach? But to make students think in three dimensions, to learn about their responses to visual phenomena, and to learn about the fundamental behavior of the material with which they work, to extract that intrinsic quality of materials, and to exploit this in their designs. When you take a piece of paper, he says, don't do anything yet, but just if I fold it in this particular way, what will happen to it? Will it stay flat on the table? Will it be unstable to only sit at 2 points? Will it sit at 4 points? Think about it. Do it in your mind first, and then he allows you to do it. And everybody sighs a sigh of relief because, oh, I never expected that, that it would, in fact, lie flat. Now, that's the kind of thinking, that kind of teaching that is desperately needed in this day. Our eyes behave and respond quite amazingly to things. There is no absolute about color. Those diagonal lines in these four fields are all of the same color, and yet to the human eye they all appear different. And why? Because color depends on where it is placed, what is around it. Now, you learn this, and the evidence is made very clear to you finally. And at what point can eyes not focus anymore? At what point do things become simply such that the human eye cannot retain them in a static way? When do colors begin to jump? When is the greatest contrast produced that generates this kind of effect, as this vibration shows? When are colors the same, and when are they, in fact, different? Here we have two fields of color, this one and that one, and one would think that they are different, and that these two, that and that, are also different. But not so. They are the same. If you take that flap and bend it across, you can see that underneath it there is the same color that goes from here right up to here. It is the same, but obviously it appears different because of the field of color in which it floats. Now, it's those awareness making exercises that are the forefront of not only the kind of teaching but also the work of the artists of the time that have influenced architecture. The minimal to achieve the most. When you just paint flat surfaces, such as Albers did here in the 1920s, suddenly a third dimension seems to appear. This is almost as if one were getting something for nothing, because it is flat over here, almost like an inlaid floor. But here it seems to generate a third dimension. In this case, in a flat layer of tones, a third dimension is generated also. But the drama comes about when he denies us the Renaissance perspective that we expect in compositions, for the eye to gather its perspective lines to a single point. He defies this, and he says, in our time, there is a new dimension which expects perspective to be altered to involve the element of time. It isn't necessarily so that this form, which we can see to be a Z form of some kind of a spatial nature, relates to this form. They become a physical impossibility. The same points in space joined become also a spatial construction with more than one vanishing points. These structural constellations, as he calls them, they pulsate, they come forward, they go back. Is this element to the four, or is this element to the four? They can be both. They are simultaneously interacting, and this is one of the characteristics of the space relationships that we will witness in architecture. Here in at the MLC Center in Sydney, his last work, in fact, is one of these large structural constellations built in the on this blank wall facing the plaza, of this same pulsating back and forth visual exercise. As in that diagram, which almost looks like the old bellows of a camera, but it is difficult to reconcile. Does the top one go inward or the bottom one come forward, or vice versa? The great spokesman at the Bauhaus, who we can use now to examine some of the characteristics that have permeated architecture in our time, is Moholy Nagy. Moholy Nagy in this painting illustrates one cardinal rule, and that is when one develops a particular geometric imagery, in this case the parallelogram, the angle that makes it up, and this angle occurs in this direction, but it also goes into the opposite direction, which finds its counterpoint in many other cases, at the ends and so on. So once an angle, once a statement is made, it is recalled, even if in a different, slightly different form. And this has its repercussions in architecture and has had it for a long time. These diagonal hangers of this structure establish a very strong geometric note, and it is recalled in the slope of this stair. Not arbitrarily different, but intentionally recalled. The counterpart to a slope is another counterslope, as in this early house, which again has a counterpart in that stair. Siegfried Gideon, the art historian, the author of Space, Time, and Architecture, one of the great treatises on this subject, pinpoints this view of the early Bauhaus that is in fact a dissolution of the corner of a building, which reveals behind it another part of the building, another layered space that has come into view because of the new transparency, the new space mode that has developed in modern architecture. And he compares this to the cubist painter who says, I will show you a object, but I will show it relatively from several points of view, which, of course, involves the element of time. To experience the frontal view, the profile view, and the rear view of a person simultaneously will give you a better image. And this simultaneous vision of two aspects of an object at the same time is what has been carried through into architecture and is the very hallmark of its characteristics. Transparency, the explosion of the traditional cube on the left into the component surfaces, which generate a transparency, a lightness, a new movement of space within and through these areas, which in themselves, generated by the confining surfaces, which is a characteristic of much modern architecture, probably one of the most seminal paintings is of this, the steel painting by Theo van Doesburg, a Dutch painter of the early era, who painted these planes in space. And this has had a great influence on much modern architecture. It's almost every building we look at, to some extent, reflects that imagery. Here's a view of an exhibition done by Breuer in the museum that he himself built in New York, the Whitney Museum, and the juxtaposition of these two planes, a wall juxtaposed and another one at right angles to it, floating over the top of it, planes suspended in space and channeling vistas between them. Architecture in recent times has been immensely concerned about this idiom of the exploitation of the interior space, which involves this simultaneous viewing of things, the channeling of vistas between its elements. We have a floor. It is interrupted, taken over by another floor at another level. The openness in between, the flow of space between these confining surfaces takes place almost in every direction. Or as Le Corbusier has said, instead of the eye and the mind being abruptly halted by edges and containing surfaces, as had been the case in the past, they are now led continuously on in exploration, never quite comprehending the mystery of layered and veiled space. But the counterparts to this early painting of Theo van Doesburg's are manifold. The juxtaposing, right-angled and spatial relationship of planes hovering in space is evident in those pieces of architecture that are aware of the tendencies of the times. And this is evident not only in three dimensions, but also in the plan form of a building. The fact that there are planes, such as this solid wall, is related to a glass wall, related to a solid wall, related to a glass wall, related to a solid wall. And the solids and the voids follow each other around, generating flows of space between them. And here we see it in three dimensions, the fact that the eye always is tempted to look beyond and never quite experiencing it all. There is a temptation with the seeing of things that are not entirely apparent, a tantalizing sense of the beyond, which you in fact are denied, and which entices the a person to move through and try and explore an interior. Probably there are no more forceful exponents of the tendency of the early part of this time and that is so much related to modern architecture than the painters who are now very much represented at the Museum of Modern Art in New York. And that is not only the steel painters, which we have already seen, but the Russian constructivists, the suprematists, the minimalists, and the spokesman for them might as well be Mondrian, whose famous paintings we see in front of us here. Now, Mondrian was one that had an enormous influence in architecture because he simply said, a balance can be a balance of unequals and not of equal things as they had always been in the past. The symmetrical concepts of tradition, where an equal thing only is ever considered to balance duly on either side of a central axis. He says that this small dark rectangle here has an appropriate weight to compete with the yellow rectangle adjacent to it. And this dynamic balance, this opposition, opposing of unequals, has had its reflection in architectural design in many different ways. Here, quite directly, almost transplanted in a simple roof structure, in a glass subdivision wall, which is recalled. Not only does it occur in this front framing, but it is also recalled to the rear in the composition of these freestanding bookshelves beyond. Glass walls, again. The disposition of unequal glass areas to the left and to the right, and the interruption of this slot, which is located in the wall, that is different here to the way it is here. And those relationships are in that oppositional, dynamic balance way. The fact that there is a vertical element here, that these horizontals, these strong horizontals, and they are offset and broken by this vertical, I think makes this composition a comparable one. Theo van Doesburg, whom we've spoken of before, has often been in this painting on the right, which we possibly will see more of, has been put together with a facade of Gropius, which we cannot see very well here, but a Mies van der Rohe floor plan. Now, the movement between the spaces of these walls is surely the same kind of pattern related into three dimensions to this picture called, I think it's called a Russian dance for some reason, but it is also the eye being channeled and never quite experiencing the total vista, but suggesting an exploration. Here's another view of that, which is entirely reminiscent of that very important plan of Mies van der Rohe's that had so much to say to modern architecture for decades, really. And here, a reflection of this mode of expression of spatial flow in the sculpture garden for a museum, how elements standing in space, channeling the eye to move along them, reflects the same tendency. As in this exhibition of free hanging exhibition panels suspended from the ceiling at right angles to each other, generating a flow of movement of a spectator through this space and engendering the same kind of spatial experience. Now, Albers was a painter who was obsessed with scintillation, with making the eye subject to vibrations. And from this, he obtained an almost a sense of movement in his paintings. This one called The City has had considerable influence on architecture, on a great deal of architecture. That is not to simply draw horizontal lines through this, but to offset them by their own thickness of line. And this quality of scintillation, of vibration, has found much parallel in architecture for other and obviously different reasons, coupled with the reasons of logic, the reasons of function, but the visual expression has some obviously similar note in the way these slots are related to the expressed floor levels of this building. Here, undeniably, a similar pattern exists, as it does in a fireplace, the back of a fireplace that Albers built of brickwork. Left out some bricks, painted the holes black inside, and gave that same sort of expression that almost exists in this in that painting. And this is almost directly translatable in this facade, which consists of the stripes, both light and dark, and the offset punctuations, which are in that checkerboard opposing fashion, very similar to those that appear in his paintings, and probably best seen in these elevations show this characteristic so much experience in architecture, the juxtaposition distribution of small buildings in this pattern form, which generates space between them. The punctuations of an open facade with the solid that opposes is in many ways reminiscent of this magnificent painting of Paul Klee's, which, although not rectilinear, but diffused almost as if squares were seen through water, but nevertheless, not only the color, but the disposition of light and dark has that same tensional, vibrating pattern that we have seen in these other instances. Now, one other element that has occurred both in modern art and in architecture, and it is never quite clear which comes first, but the phenomenon can be observed in both disciplines, is the reversal, the tensional relationship between reversing from plus to minus, from minus back to plus, or from short to long, from long to short. In this disposition of buildings, we have a long building disposed identically to that short one, that this long one and its angle is recalled in that short one and its angling, and so on, and throughout the whole composition. Now, this has been the key of a lot of modern abstract painters' work. In this case, the short, the long, the angles oppose and recall in a reverse symmetrical way, as do these buildings. As does this painting by Albers. Here again, we have the long, recalled, the long, the short, enticing compositions that have all kinds of spatial connotations as well. But for the moment, let us just examine that particular aspect, reverse symmetry. It occurs a great deal in modern architecture. This form repeated here, the small form repeated there. And that surely can be seen to be the same tendency in this composition of buildings that relate in that same diametrically opposed reverse symmetrical way. Now, in recent times, very new developments have taken place in painting, but again, allied to the concern about vision, how the eye responds to certain criteria. The Protractor series of paintings by the American painter Frank Stellar have been much acclaimed throughout the Western world. He takes a simple, minimal element, such as the curve, be it a semicircle or a quadrant, and he juxtaposes those into each other to make compositions which are, in this case, also related to the rectangle that surrounds them and permeates even the interior of this composition. The quadrant, the half circle, and their opposition not only in form, but also in color. The minimal statement of this kind, the quadrant. The quadrant stated once and stated again in the broken form. Here it reoccurs, it stops, it picks up here and completes and is related within that circumscribing rectilinear geometry. Now, this has had its counterparts in architecture. The quadrant, once used, is used in the convex and concave form. The convex, the opposing concave. The New York painter Sol LeWitt, who recently was in Australia and painted a form in for our art gallery, an amazing the similar direction of compositions restricting themselves to the quadrant, which also Kahlberg uses in this in on itself reversing saddle-like form. And there's no doubt that these two quadrant-shaped garden walls use a similar theme, as does this composition of two buildings, quadrant-shaped, opposing each other, never going the same way, but maximizing the opposition, the dynamics of opposing same forms, but making them move in opposite directions, as does this concave surface with this convex surface here. And of course, the Australian Embassy in Paris uses two buildings that are of opposing quadrant forms. The same here of a theater, function center being built in Melbourne reflects that same oppositional view, which forms the key point to its elements. Here, Kahlberg, not using just a parallel quadrant, but in fact a solid quadrant. The solid quadrant occurs in this work, which is a solid form, a quarter of a cylinder, juxtaposed with others, likewise forms, identical forms, and these are made into compositions, in this case an outdoor sculpture, which has at its very core the opportunity to redo, to restructure, to reassemble in different ways. Almost endless variety can ensue from these compositions. The sculptor Charles Perry similarly puts together here conical forms that are made of a single component, in this case repeated six times, which achieve that form and yet can be assembled in a multiplicity of ways, such as is shown here. Now, this harks back to the developments of industry, of course, is the fact that you can make things in mass production, but the key is the more you make of them and the more you put them together, the more interesting they should become, such as this single element of a twisted column element here, three times vertically used by Kahlberg, and its reversal, its own reversal adjacent, producing some enticing spatial movement through it. Using only a single element, a semicircular rod, sprayed out in this bunched fashion in various directions, achieves a geometric, almost mathematical precision of an enticing form as transparent as it is consequential in its totality, hanging as a sculpture here from the ceiling in the Theatre Royal. Opened up twisted mace-like forms generate a space flow between them and two semicircles that make them up, as is this own self-reversal of a bronze form of Kahlberg's, where one side is identical to the other and yet spatially reversed at right angles to itself. Max Bill, one of the founders seminal figures in painting and sculpture, produced this half sphere of opposing semicircles in the positive and negative form. Here it is convex and concave together, meeting at this single point, being half a sphere. If you agree, this is obviously a counterpoint of mass-produced components in a roof structure that can be made by our industrial means, is undoubtedly a counterpoint to it. Now, another element is that of the free form. And the painter that has been most seminal in dispensing this sort of view of the visual world, is Hans Arp. And he has had an influence on architects such as Le Corbusier. Here's his Harvard building, and the free form juxtaposed with the rectilinear. Here we see his free forms jutting out the curve in one direction, the curve in the opposite direction of this pedestrian ramp. I think as they have all had things to do with this painterly origin, such as this form of a swimming pool and its surrounding walls. Calder. Opposing here the most earthbound triangular solid form with a suspended moving mobile structure above it, not only opposing the solidity and the free form suspended in movement above it, it relates very much also in another mode to this painter Nolan, who has found his parallel in architecture by defying again the Renaissance view of the single perspective line. None of them really meet a single point, although they tantalize the eye as though they did, and that also can find its parallel in architecture in juxtaposing identical or near identical buildings to move visually in different ways. The buildings are related, but in no apparent discernible geometric traditional pattern. Finally, the sculptor. The sculptor's language has always been one that has been most related to architecture. Henry Moore has for many years hollowed out his sculptures, which is a new vision compared to that of the past, which has tended to be the solid cube, the solid element surrounded by air. Here we have solidity penetrated by air. And we are viewing the surroundings through the object itself. The dissolution, the dematerialization of solidity that has occurred in the painter's world, very much emphasized by the sculptor as well as the architect. Le Corbusier's Villa Savoie at Poissy near Paris is in fact penetrated. The eye looks right through this exterior space, which is frozen and contained within the circumscribing rectilinear form of the building. Gropius and Breuer have built many structures that are in fact not only lifted off the ground, but their very flow of space goes right through the conventionally solid object of a building, which is held on visually negligible support, these tiny columns, which is so much another way of saying that solidity is nothing to our eyes. Solidity we can capture by our technological means, and this transparent staircase is evidence of that too, that in fact you do the minimal thing, it is rigid, and yet you can look right through it. Picasso's famous sculpture in the center of Chicago is some evidence of this also, of the elements of the plates that make up this form being in fact transparent. Calder, in his Starbeal sculpture outside Australia Square, entices the eye to move through and around it, and is constantly confronted with transparencies and vistas through. Moore, to come back to him, takes these forms and relates them, the sharp to the soft, in a particular way that has an architectural feel about it. Here we have the same, the broad as against the sharp, the edge of architecture against the surface of architecture in compositions that reveal the spaces beyond. We cannot quite see the fact that the Eiffel Tower here, seen between these two buildings, actually reoccurs right through the center of the building and reestablishes itself when looking through it. And here the sky not only occurs above the building, but it occurs right through the building. there can be no doubt that this is a powerful painterly, sculpturally element that has reoccurred in architecture almost throughout the times. And here on the interior, even the freestanding fireplace reveals the area beyond as much as it does the space around it. To sum up, I would say that these tendencies shown are not necessarily evident to most people. People tend to not want formulas, not want to recognize criteria that should guide us. But in my view, unless there are criteria, unless there is consensus about that which does influence and tantalize the eye in our age, it will be very difficult for us to find and explore those directions that have proven, at least for half, if not three quarters of a century, to be considered beautiful, satisfying, and worthy of pursuit into the future.